Good morning, Los Angeles First United Methodist Church. It is Sunday, August 1st. Today, we're coming to you with the anticipated hope that we can continue being safe and responsible people. It has been a long season of us enduring this pandemic, and the best way for us to do it is to continue to be safe and mindful. So please, friends, wear your masks. Wear them over your mouth and nose. I know it's hot. I know it's uncomfortable. But also, if you have not yet been vaccinated, please, please do. It is safe. It is the only way for us to pull through this together. Just this week, we had the heartbreaking news that our friend and colleague, Myron Wingfield, died on Wednesday. I understand that he died of COVID. And Myron was somebody who has had a long, beautiful, rich, and wonderful life. And Myron was vaccinated. But because the variant is spreading so quickly, it affected him. And Myron is just one of the hundreds of thousands of Americans that we have lost. Over 200,000 cases have been reported this week. Numbers are climbing. It's still serious. So friends, if you know and love Myron, we hold him deeply in our hearts today. Know and understand that we wouldn't recommend something if it wasn't safe and right for you. But talk to your doctor. Get a handle on this yourself. Talk to medical experts who know you and your body. And let's do what we can to prevent the spread of this virus. Friends, with that, our theme for today is repentance. And we'll dive deeper into it in a moment. But as we get into today, I want to invite you to just center yourself. Take a deep breath and invite the Holy Spirit to guide us this morning.
The wind blows hard against this mountainside, across the sea into my soul. It reaches into where I cannot hide, setting my feet upon the road. Old, it holds my memories. My body burns a gem like flame. Somewhere between the soul and soft machine is where I find myself again. Kyrie eleison down the road that I must travel. Of the night, Kyrie eleison, where I'm going, will you follow? Kyrie eleison, on the highway in the light. Kyrie eleison, down the road that I must travel. Kyrie eleison, through the darkness of the night.
What a wonderful way for us to get started today. We do have a number of announcements. And my favorite thing, the thing that has kept us from being just a totally depressing enterprise this year, is the fact that we can stay connected in the chat. Most of our folks tend to be over on Facebook Live, but if you're joining us from YouTube, which I see Byron and Deanne are this morning, YouTube, Periscope on Twitter, those are other great places. I get to see everybody's comments over here, but Facebook is the primary place where a congregation stays connected. So good morning, Lauren. Good morning, everyone. I am a couple of seconds ahead of you in real time, so occasionally I'll say something and there will be a bit of a delay. So if you're waiting on me to respond, it's because we have a little bit of a cyber disconnect, but we're all here and together, and I'm really grateful. We invite you to use the chat to talk with one another, to share thoughts, ideas, prayer requests when the time comes, but just to say hi. Find your ways to stay connected here too. We do have a few announcements this morning. Savannah is here with us today in the chat, functioning as the Los Angeles First United Methodist Church avatar. So if you have any particular questions or need to follow up on a link, Savannah is here to add those in for you. We'd like you to know that, what do I want you to know? I have no idea. It's August and my brain is melting and I'm really hot and tired, which is probably true for all of us. I just need everything to just slow down for a second. So tomorrow night we will be having Disciple Bible study from 5:30 to 7:30 via Zoom. And then we're taking 2 weeks off for a variety of reasons. One, it's summer and we just need a little bit of a break. This has been a very long and intense and wonderful study. But in order to endure that, we also need some breaks. So we will be off for a couple of weeks and then we'll come back together on August 23rd, which is the first day of school. My word, I can't believe it. Continue to pray for teachers and administrators and students. We have a really tricky situation in the world, but I'm thinking particularly in our country right now, where kids are going to be required to wear masks, where people are half vaccinated because they can be, and half not because they've either chosen not to be or aren't eligible yet. This is going to be a really, really hard road for us to navigate together. So I'm already praying for that. But also, I am delighted that my kids can go to school. We have been together so much and it's been truly wonderful, but you know, we all kind of need to figure out who we are outside our home again. So prayers for our teachers, for administrators, for everybody making those decisions and preparations, and kids, whew, we pray for you too. This has been really hard and your childhood has been shaped by it. So we hold you in our prayers too. So as we look ahead, our sermon series on Cultivate will continue through September 12th, and it is our anticipation that we would like to reopen in person on September 12th. We are calling that our homecoming Sunday. But of course, we're paying attention, and if the numbers continue to rise, at this point it would not be safe or wise for us to reopen and regather. It is a tricky situation for us in our setting because we are so public. It is the best part of what it is to be Los Angeles First United Methodist Church, that we get to gather outside, under tents, together in the middle of the city. But given all of these circumstances and the Delta variant and the challenges of staying masked or wondering if people who are unmasked may be vaccinated or not, it's really tricky for us to keep each other safe. So for now, we're just going to hold that date on our calendar, continue to make wise, prudent decisions around what is best for our congregation and our community. So continue to pray, continue to be wise, continue to ask questions, and we're grateful that you're here and hope to see you soon. We do have a new mailing address. So if you have anything to mail, you can send it to P.O. Box 173, South Pasadena, California, 91031. Oh, I did it. Yay. Just when I memorized the old address, we got a brand new one. So that's where you can send us anything. Love letters, don't send hate mail, but if you do, that's where it should go. You can send anything else there. It's where all of our bills are routed, so that's where to find us. We have a very important and kind of fun and exciting announcement. You know, every week we do our best to present new and vibrant and interesting material for you, and that is especially true when it comes to our music. And our production team is also our music team, and they've been working really hard to do both, to both write and record these arrangements that they have composed themselves, but also to present them in interesting and thoughtful ways to us every Sunday. And regardless of being in person or not, video content has now become a critical piece of who we are and what we do. So as we're looking ahead, we'll probably continue to keep using video in some interesting ways. And this Wednesday, we would love your help. If you have a 30-minute window of time between 12 p.m. and 6 p.m., and we realize if you have a day job and you're confined to either your office or your computer in some way, and you may be interested but might need some wiggle room in that time, just email Stephen and see if he can work that out with you. We're looking for people to come and participate in the video that we're putting together for next week. It involves no audio. You don't have to sing or speak at all. It's your visual presence lip syncing. And it will be a song that you're familiar with, and if you're not, it's just little clips so you can memorize it and get it together. Some musicality is helpful if you're able to stay on beat and lip sync with the music. That's helpful. But if you just want to help us out, we would be really, really grateful. We need as many of you as possible. So let Stephen know. His email is in the order of worship. I'm going to ask Savannah to put Stephen's email in the chat, and then you can get together with him and figure out. There we go. She did it. Savannah, you're 8 steps ahead of me. You can email Stephen to sign up for that. Thanks, Lauren. I was hoping you would. Parsonage residents, this may or may not be optional for you. I think you may have to. We also want to remind you that the UMW book group will be starting next Sunday, August 8th at Via Flores at 2 p.m. in person for the first meeting if you are interested. But if you are just being mindful or cautious, or frankly just prefer Zoom because it works for you in your setting, that is totally fine. They will have a laptop available so you can participate via Zoom as well as in person. The book is called Push Out, The Criminalization of Black Girls in Schools by Monique Morris. It is based on a documentary, so if you're a visual person and you want to engage the content that way before diving into the book, you have that possibility before you. They will be reading chapter one for next week, introduction chapter one, and then reading through chapter five. They'll begin meeting on Wednesdays at 6 p.m. via Zoom on August 18th, 25th, September 1st, and September 8th. So it's a short-term study. It's only, I'm bad at math, 5 meetings. And if you want to, you can email Lauren Korzakowski. Her email is very helpfully in the chat. There's no way I could say all that out loud, but we invite you to come and participate. The study will be really, really interesting. The United Methodist Women are having a silent auction on Saturday, August 14th at 11 a.m. via Zoom. So wherever you are, wherever you may be, you can participate. It will be a fun and lighthearted program. And the auction, they're auctioning off things you really want. There is a spa basket for self-care, and I don't care how you identify gender-wise, that basket sounds lovely. All of us could use a little bit of self-care. So please make sure you check the link. You can email Diane Jin at dlokgin@gmail.com if you would like the link to register. And thanks also to Debbie, who has contributed, I think, not one but 2 bottles of her brother's Vineyards wine, which is delicious. So take a look. There are some community resources also available to you. South Park is still continuing to figure out how to be safely engaged in the world. The Sounds of South Park is still going on, and the Petroleum Building on Fridays from 6 to 8. There are cooling centers as the heat continues to be oppressive. I think that's fair. We are really, really hoping that we can find some relief, and the rain that we saw last week was minimal, but such a blessing. So if you're in the need of a place to stay cool, you can go and find that at LA County. Good morning, Miriam. And my dogs are saying hello too. All God's creatures. I believe those are all of our announcements for now. So we will invite you to put your prayers, your joys, and concerns. If you'd like to share those in the chat, you're welcome to do so. I'm gonna go see what's up with my dogs. They're registering their complaints right now. And we'll invite you to share those joys and concerns now.
grace, streams of mercy never ceasing, sulfur songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious song sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mountain I'm fixed upon it, mount of God's redeeming love. And here I raise my Ebenezer, hear the by thy help I've come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it for thy courts above.
Thank you all for sharing these beautiful joys and your concerns. I'm always touched by your thoughtfulness and by the good things that are going on in your life. I don't even know where to start. First of all, Savannah, thank you. Savannah added a couple of announcements that I skipped over because I was distracted by the barking. There is one more week of Mission U. It goes through Sunday, August 8th. And today in South Park, there is a DTLA Marketplace and LA Art Show. That is in the weekly resource email. And if you don't get that, send Savannah an email, office@lafirstumc.org. And Mark, congratulations. First of all, it's always so glad to see you, Mark. You're just a wonderful gift to our community. And no matter where you live, it is so great that we can stay connected. So congrats on your new condo. That is fantastic. Everyone is blessed to have a place, but when it is perfect and just right for you, congratulations. We're really thrilled for you. Oscar, my friend, good morning. I'm always so grateful for you and for your prayers and for the ways that you continually lift up the needs of our houseless community into our prayers. Thank you for being who you are. It is such a blessing to have you as our friend. Yes, Stephen was mentioning that these were some of the first songs we recorded during the pandemic, so this was a bit of a flashback Sunday for us. And Elaine, we are praying for your son as he makes this transition. I know it will be both a blessing for you, and always every blessing has its little tint of concern, that he transitions well, that he is able to do all the things he hopes to do to care for himself, and that it becomes a blessing to you as he moves into this new space. Savannah, your joy is just tremendous. And I saw both your Nana and your mom who were commenting earlier. Savannah got to spend some wonderful time back at home in Atlanta with her Nana and her mama and other family, your aunt, your uncle. I'm so grateful that you had this time. It has been a really long year for all of us, but you have added on a lot of layers of complexity and powered through them with a lot of grace and a lot of possibility and hope for your future. So it's always good to go home and get rooted and to get grounded and to just receive the love and care and nurture and reminder of who you are, where you came from, and who is rooting for you no matter where you are. So we're glad all of you are here today. Yes, Mark, on a related note, praying for those who might be affected by the end of the eviction moratorium, which is coming at the end of September, sorry, the end of August. There are a lot of challenges around that. There are some people sympathetic to landlords who utilize that money for their well-being, and that's obviously a problem, and we're grateful for the ways that the government has been able to step in. But honestly, there have been so many tenants who have borne the brunt of those challenges of what it means to have to gather paperwork, to provide documentation, to navigate a complex bureaucratic system. It's really hard. So we are praying for everybody who might be affected, that we don't see a wave of people unhoused simply because of some bureaucratic challenges there. And we pray for grace more than anything, grace upon grace, that everybody who is experiencing financial hardship, which affects our housing capacity, that we might find some way through. Marshall, good morning to you. Prayers for Samuel's work. As he continues to improve, and that everyone can remember that the pandemic will not be over until everyone everywhere is safe. And Marshall is always so thoughtful to remind us about the vaccination rates in other places, because the vaccine was not available as quickly or widely as it was in the United States. So this is a true privilege that we have access to it. Olu, bless you, my friend. Joy that your friend is back home from the hospital. That is a true joy. Debbie, thank you. We continue to hold our entire planet in our prayers, and I don't mean to say that flippantly at all. We are experiencing incredibly high heat. There are floods in places it doesn't typically flood, and of course here in California, our danger is fires. In the last week, there have been fires nearby. The fires that have started back in July have not yet been contained. This is a really, really serious concern, and until we realize the ways that we can make some vital changes, we're going to continue to see the Earth's response to how it's been treated. Oh, Scotty, yes, the uptick in cases in your hometown has been really challenging. It's tripled, and everyone is very worried. And prayers for your arm and shoulder, that you can continue to find some relief and care for that and get some rest. Oh, Lauren, joy that you saw the family you used to babysit for. You saw your first live stand-up comedy performance? Please tell us who it was, and if there are appropriate jokes to share, do so. And if they're inappropriate, tell us later. Inappropriate jokes are always fun too, but only in the right setting. So congrats. I'm so eager for us to be able to get back to doing things. So please, everyone, do your best to keep everybody safe, including yourself. And yes, Lauren, we continue to pray for you as your first draft of your research project is upcoming. I love this prayer. Savannah, grateful for the congresswomen that are leading the charge to extend the eviction moratorium. Amen to that. Cori Bush has been really vocal about it and unafraid to back down. It's so challenging to read and talk at the same time, but I'm really, really grateful for you. Okay. All right. I think those are all of our prayer requests and comments, and in the context of a personal conversation, this is where we just sort of pipe up and share wonderful things. So thank you for piping up and sharing wonderful things, but also the things that are really tender to your heart. When burdens are heavy, we believe that we can bear them better when they are shared. Ashley, I'm so glad to see you. I was thinking of you this morning. You did a very nice yoga video yesterday. That's awesome. And you get to return to theater this week. Oh, congrats. Oscar, we give thanks for you all the time. All the time. So thankful for you. And bless you, Miriam. You and Victor are doing so much to care for so many people, especially those who have been so vulnerable. And I'm grateful for the ways you've been able to keep them safe. Bless you and thank you. Okay. This is a really good morning. There's a lot of energy coming from you, and I hope you feel my love for you as well. Hi, Dad. Hi, Mom. So let's take this time to pray. I have challenges over here with these small puppies that I've adopted, so I invite you to pray for their ability to problem solve and go through the open door instead of clawing at the one that's closed. All right, friends, let's pray. Holy, gracious, and loving God, we give you thanks for who you are. We give you thanks for who you have made us to be. We give you thanks for the possibilities we have to take power over the things that feel as though they are powerless in our lives. Help us to make good choices for ourselves, for our bodies, for our souls, for our hearts. Help us to make good choices for our planet. We have been presented with options. We have been given the easy way. And so often we have to take it because everything else is so hard. But offer us new and thoughtful ways to see our way through, to find a pathway that we can trod gently, that it will leave simple footsteps for others to follow as we continue to walk toward the kingdom which you have invited to co-create with you here on earth. I ask that you bless everyone who is sick and suffering. For those who are in the medical field who have seen firsthand the horrors of this pandemic, we invite you to give peace to our souls, rest to our weariness, and a calmness to our anxiety. Give us grace to be at peace with one another and at peace within ourselves. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless them, silly puppies. So, friends, this morning I'm really excited about our text because it's serious. The last few weeks we have been reading about different gospels and Jesus' perspective on a variety of things, and I really appreciate the idea that we can cultivate different aspects of our life. But today, especially as we're sitting in an earth that is burning up around us, our theme for today is repentance. And, you know, repentance is, you know, a tricky theme, and if you're a United Methodist, like we happen to be, we don't talk a lot about repentance or sin or death or hell or that great passage where John the Baptist is like, repent and sin no more, and he's eating weird stuff and wearing locusts, and he eats the locust, he's wearing other weird stuff. Repentance is real and it's important, and the first part of repentance is acknowledging that we need it. So the passage that we're going to read today is from the Psalms. I don't often preach from the Psalms, but today was a day to do so because I think this will help guide and shape our conversation. But this psalm was written, allegedly, by David after he had been confronted by the prophet Nathan. Okay, so back in 2 Samuel, there was this whole story, maybe you're familiar with it, where David, King David, the beloved, yes, that David, David and Goliath David, beloved of God, chosen by God, anointed and appointed by God to lead the Israelites. David, who has every good gift, who has the capacity to love and the best way to demonstrate that. King David has at his disposal everything, including God's favor. And yet, David was not satisfied. And had we read the passage from the lectionary last week from 2 Samuel, we would have gotten the story about David and Bathsheba, where he sees a beautiful woman bathing. She is minding her own business. She is not doing anything exotic or erotic. She is simply bathing where people bathe. And David sees her and decides that he would like her for his own. And when he discovers she's married, he sends her husband's, he invites her to come over and has his way with her. She then, fearing being pregnant, tells David that she is married, and he sends her husband to the front lines in battle, and her husband Uriah is killed. And the prophet Nathan is sent by God to go and confront David about all that he has done. And the story is really compelling and very, very interesting, and I won't read it in its entirety. I'm just trying to summarize it for you to give us some context. Because Nathan goes to David and says, you know, had someone, a rich man, had very many flocks, and a poor man had but one little ewe lamb, and the rich man took that lamb. He took the poor man's lamb and prepared it for the guest who had come to him. David's anger was greatly kindled and said, "As the Lord lives, the man who has done this deserves to die. He shall restore the lamb fourfold because he did this thing and because he had no pity." And Nathan says to David, one of the best lines in the entire Hebrew Bible, he says to him, "You are the man. You are the one who had everything and took one thing from someone else." He is convicted of this crime. And David says to Nathan, "I have sinned against the Lord." I'm vastly summarizing this, and the link is available in the order of worship, 2 Samuel chapter 11, verse 26 through chapter 12, verse 13. So it's there if you'd like to go read it in its entirety. But it's important context as we get to our psalm. So Nathan, in this, you know, prophetic and sort of utilizing a parable, comes to David and is able to persuade him of his own guilt. Now, this is step one. This is usually where the plan falls apart, right? Like, you can give someone a parable and they could say, oh, I clearly see who the bad guy is in that story. But you and I and all people are inclined to see ourselves as the protagonist in every narrator, in every narrative. We always think we're the good guy. And Nathan comes to David and says, here's a parable about a man who had everything, who took one thing from the man who had nothing. And David can see clearly who did something wrong. Nathan's words to him, you are the man. You are the one who took it. It flips David's perspective on the narrative on its head. He goes from being the protagonist to realizing with a heart-sunken sorrow that he is the villain. He is the man who did something terribly wrong. Now, why didn't it occur to him ahead of time? That's a conversation for David to have with Jesus and God and the Holy Spirit and anybody else who will listen. And to an extent, we don't get to judge why David didn't figure that out sooner. What we do have is the opportunity to hear David's prayer. Would you excuse me for just a moment? I ask you to talk amongst yourselves. I have been convicted by this tiny face. He has done something wrong. He is the man, so he must leave. My apologies. So this leads us to our psalm this morning. So I invite you, if you're interested, you can read this from Psalm 51, verses 1 through 12. This is a prayer for cleansing and pardon. A psalm of David when the prophet Nathan came to him after he had gone into Bathsheba. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy. Blot out my transgressions and wash me thoroughly from my iniquity. Cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against you and you alone I have sinned, and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified in your sentence and blameless when you pass judgment. Indeed, I was born guilty, a sinner when my mother conceived me. You desire truth in the inward being. Therefore, teach me wisdom in my secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain in me a willing spirit. Friends, this is the word of God from us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. O God, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. So, friends, I gave you a long prolegomena to the sermon before the sermon, but I feel like it's important. And today, as we receive this, as we receive this invitation to repentance, the trickiest part about repenting is realizing that we're not always the protagonist, that someone is writing a narrative about us, and it's probably going to put us in a light, one, that we can't control, and two, that we need to hear. Now, I am exempting the idea, and Jesus will speak a lot about this, about being wrongly accused, right? False narratives were used to condemn Jesus that led him to be crucified. So in this instance, I'm not talking about people who are simply lying to affect your character. There's plenty of gaslighting nonsense that goes on in the world, that this is separate and distinct from that. Regardless of how manipulative some people and circumstances can be, I think what's important for us to take from this is that there are people in our lives whose opinions matter. And one of the most important lines in this psalm is that David says, "Against you and you alone have I sinned, O God." Now, yes, of course, David has sinned against Bathsheba. David has sinned against Uriah. David has sinned against everybody who has ever trusted him. But David lands this squarely in God's lap. And one of the tricky parts about David, as Ashley has pointed out, is that David is continually privileged. And here's the thing. Most privileged circumstances avoid the worst consequences. Money can buy our way out of a lot of things. Privilege and favor gets us really far when we have it. So this is somebody with the absolute most privilege and favor of almost anyone in the biblical narrative. And yet, David is not without consequence. And he knows. And he knows. So as much as he has to apologize to Bathsheba, to make amends for all he has done, to repay fourfold what he has taken, which he can't do. He cannot restore a life that was robbed. His manipulation of those circumstances is deeply troubling. And it tells us something about David that reminds us that we share this sinfulness. David's repentance means that he can look inward and see that he was born sinful from birth. I was born guilty, a sinner when my mother conceived me. But here's the thing with this psalm and every psalm, is that as much as David is convicted of his sinfulness, of his guilt, he doesn't leave it there. And if we're to cultivate some kind of repentance, it absolutely begins with the idea that we need to recognize for ourselves what other people's trusted people's complaints are about us. And it's awful, and it's hard, because we know our feelings. And inviting ourselves to be in someone else's shoes is really challenging. To see their experience of the world and how a particular incident or conversation might have affected them from their circumstance. Well, frankly, friends, that's the whole argument we're having around critical race theory now. The idea that we should take a look at our history and place it squarely out of the mouths that have been typically taking it, and into the mouths of those who have been silenced, who experience things like enslavement. Critical race theory is the invitation to review history through the eyes of those who experienced it through oppression. Because colonialism has written a history that celebrates the most horrific atrocities we could imagine. And that is not who we're invited to be as Christians. This is the precise thing that we learn from David and Bathsheba in this narrative, that Nathan comes to David and says, "You are the man. You are the colonial empire. You are the one who has taken what did not belong to you and exploited it for your own good. You are the man who has done that." And David, despite all of his terrible, seemingly unforgivable flaws, is the one who is going to teach us what it means to be privileged and repentant. And if there is one thing we need to learn right now as Americans in the year of our Lord 2021, it is how to be both privileged and repentant. To see how much we are in need of mercy. Mercy that is beyond our own capacity. Most of us don't have the capacity to be that forgiving. We can't even begin to forgive ourselves, much less imagine that the one we have hurt could forgive us. That the history and legacy of the land we sit on, which was robbed from those who had cultivated and nurtured it as they were intended to do. There's no way we can repent enough for those sins. and it's almost impossible to believe we could be forgiven. And the conversation around reparations begins in a place that we can't imagine, because we all know deep down we can't repair what we have broken. And when David says, repay it fourfold, how? How can you begin to quantify the experiences, the opportunity, the lives, the freedom that was taken? And frankly, the calculus doesn't work. And so we shut down because there's no way to pay equal reparation for what was taken. You cannot repay four lambs for one. It doesn't work that way. It's not that simple, because we owe more than we took. The compound interest on our sins is enormous. And that is something that David teaches us too. David cannot repay what he took. This isn't four lambs for one. So David begins with repentance. And the very act of becoming the villain in the story and seeing himself through the lens of accusation without defense, that's a hard thing to do. And I'm not here to celebrate David. I am merely here to show us that it is possible for us to repent. If David can repent, so can we. And the only reason repentance is possible is because of the very thing that David points us to, which is that we have sinned before the Lord, and it is God alone who both judges and offers forgiveness. And we, friends, and I've said this many, many times, and I'll say it again, we are invited into the conditional relationship of forgiveness. We say every Sunday in the Lord's Prayer, the prayer that Jesus taught us, forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. The condition of forgiveness means that we have to have the capacity to forgive as well. So the person who has harmed you the most is just as deserving of your forgiveness as we are of God's. And we have sinned. We have sinned against God, against our ancestors, against those who came before us. We have sinned against our future. The reason we are so concerned is not that we can correct the world for tomorrow, it's that we can correct it for the generations ahead of us, for your grandchildren and great-grandchildren, for your descendants, for generations forever. That's who we are designed to care for. Our results are seeds that will be reaped in the future. And it can begin with us repenting, turning away, seeing our own convictedness. And when we can do so without defense, with pure awareness, that is a heavy, heavy moment, my friends. It's heavy to think about how much we owe back. But David doesn't leave us in this place. David turns directly to God and says, "You and you alone have the capacity to forgive. Create in me a clean heart. I know my transgressions. My sin is ever before me." And the first line of this psalm is, "Mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions." And it seems problematic to begin with mercy, but it is the only way David's psychological being can acknowledge all that he has done. So we pray first for mercy. Have mercy on us, O mighty God, for all that we have done and left undone, for the reparations we cannot pay because we see how much we owe. Have mercy on us, blot out our sin, forgive us our transgressions, and create a new heart. For us today, this will mean repenting making amends, having really hard conversations, acknowledging to someone who we've been battling that they were right, but we were too proud or stubborn to see it or acknowledge it, because we would have been too ashamed. The thing that David truly sacrifices here is his pride, which needed to go. It was his pride that led him to behave in such ways. It was his pride that kept him from seeing how awful this was. And at the end of the day, our pride gets us nowhere. It doesn't even protect us. It's just a shield we carry that is too heavy, and it occupies our hands and prevents us from doing other things, like offering help to others, seeing someone else's perspective, reflecting on things in a new light, seeing that maybe someone's cry for help is not a form of weakness, but it is because of a circumstance we had a hand in creating. And if we can step out of our own place of pride and welcome the shame that comes with it, knowing full well that God and God alone is the judge, and that God and God alone has the capacity to forgive us of our shame, to blot out our transgressions, to forgive us of our sins. And ultimately, God does. But just like any relationship, we have to participate in that. We have to invite a conversation with God that begins with, "Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. Create in me a new heart and put a new and right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence." I think what we can take from this is both a deep and profound awareness of our capacity to sin and our ability to stare our most shameful things directly in the eye and say, "I did some terrible things. I hurt people. And I'm deeply repentant of that, and want to do what I can, even if I can't repair it one for one, but to begin to build and mend a bridge to the future that the consequences of my actions will no longer ripple. That I can begin to build a healing bridge in relationships, in systems, in circumstances, in the future." When Jesus gathered his disciples together on the night that he was to be arrested, before he was crucified, he reminded them of this very thing. He took the bread, gave thanks to God, broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. If that's not mercy, friends, I don't know what is. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, Jesus took the cup, gave it to his disciples, and said, "This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." So it is in remembrance of these, God's mighty acts in Christ Jesus, that we offer ourselves as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. We do this as we proclaim the great mystery of our faith, that Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body of Christ, that we can be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Holy Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Friends, I'll invite you to pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. I invite you to do so in the language in which you learned it first and best. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Friends, I'll invite you to partake of your communion with whomever you may be with, wherever you may be, whatever you may have, and do so knowing that you are worthy of love and forgiveness and repentance. Thank you all for being with us today. I'm really grateful and thankful for your participation in your own spiritual journey, and for sharing that with us is just such a blessing. We'll remind you that our virtual coffee hour will begin shortly. It takes me a moment to transition from one virtual environment to the next, but you can find us on Zoom. I do believe that Savannah has already posted that link in the chat, so be sure to join us in 4 minutes when that starts. We will see you soon, friends. So go knowing that God is with you, God is for you, and God refuses to be God without you. May all God's people say, Amen.